The only reason the band started was complete boredom. Our first gig was in Mullingar in a place called Bambricks that was on a Wednesday night. Even then, people came up and said, you know, you should probably pursue a bit more seriously. And we did. The first gig we did in Whelan's, like, it was on a Monday night and it was totally sold out. And granted, a lot of it was from people going up to Mullingar. So from then on, every gig we did, people would be like, "Ash, it's only full because people are coming up from Mullingar." I'm like, well, you know, that's a bit of a kick in the arse. You know, what that gig did was generated a bit of a buzz, and people were like, well, how did they sell out Whelan's on a Monday night? And then more people came to see us. And as we're that type of band, you will find it very hard to get us by listening to our record. You have to come into a room and see us play live. That's what's got us fans, when they're in a room, small little room, it's sweaty and there's a bit of energy. I would have been surprised if we were a left of centre, you know, alternative indie band, but we weren't. We were like, we knew exactly where we were going and where we wanted to go, and those songs, like Fantasy, for example, was a good, well, you know, constructed pop track, and that's what we kind of went for. We knew when that was written and recorded, we were like, okay, there's absolutely no reason in the world this can't do well. So I think we were quite confident with it, and when you have confidence in something, other people start kind of believing you too.
And the nominees for Best Irish Live Performance are...
I don't often say this, but we deserved it. Like, we did deserve it. We worked incredibly hard in our live show. And, you know, the bands we were up against as well, like, they all deserved it too, but we won it, so I'm just delighted we won it.
And the winner is... fantastic. The Blizzards!
But then walking down to get it was just kind of... I was like, kind of, look, for the first time in my life, I don't want to be the front man anymore. I don't want to be the singer, can someone else do this? And then you realise when you're in that position, your mind goes blank, so you just end up saying something either hugely moving or hugely stupid.
All we can say is, I suppose, we want to thank the people who dragged themselves out of their tent on that pissy wet Sunday morning in oxygen to see us play. You've contributed to something that will stick with us for the rest of our lives. Thanks a million. Cheers.
The best moment was after getting the award, we turned around and we were being directed off stage by, you know, the models, and Charlize Theron and Stuart Townsend were standing at the bottom of the steps. And I think she must be used to this, but the five of us stopped, I'd say for at least 60 seconds, maybe 2 minutes, and just stared at her. Didn't say hello, didn't say anything, just stared at her really sleazily, and then just kind of got pushed on. And then we walked up, and I didn't think we talked for about 5 minutes after that. And then we realised, I mean, you probably saw the most beautiful woman, and she was 2 yards away from you, and you had an award. A lot of bands were on before us and after us and all. They do that maybe 15, 20 times every summer on the festival circuit. We don't have that luxury. So this was like our swan song, and we're on stage, and you see a lot of the bands kind of going through the motions, going, oh yeah, I'm doing this again tomorrow with Tea in the Park, whatever. But to us, it was like, you know, this is like 40, 45 minutes an hour where we have to actually pull out the finger. That's what makes it easier for us on the main stage. But the main stage is less daunting to me than a tent or like the NME stage, which we did 3 years ago. I find the main stage is more a kind of almost a card given to you from the promoter or stuff saying, listen, we know you're good enough to take the stage. Don't worry about it. we wouldn't have put you on here if we didn't think you were capable of it. And it was a, more a confidence booster to us, more than a kind of like, oh no, it's the main stage. The best part about the music scene in Ireland at the moment is no band sounds like the next. No established band sounds like, no one can say we sound like the Cronas or Republic Loose or anything like that. And you know, in other territories, a lot of artists sound like the next and stuff like that. That's what I think is healthy about the scene in Ireland. But what I also think is healthy is that I know if we're sharing stage with Republic Loose, that if we're not absolutely at the top of our game live-wise, we're going to be made look like second-class citizens. And that's, there is that kind of, you know, not, I wouldn't say competition, but it keeps you on your toes live-wise. Got a pain in my head, think of things that I've said. Get your horns and fire for burning one in desire. When introductions are met, it's in your ego's given. Find another release in chronic rather disease. Some say, I suppose, that like Tony Visconti was kind of the king of the 70s, and you know, each producer had their decade. I think Beinhorn was quite a substantially well-known producer in the 90s. He'd done some of the probably biggest records of my generation, like Soundgarden, Super Unknown, and he did the first Red Hot Chili Peppers record and a few Marilyn Manson records. One thing I learned from Michael Beinhorn and his production style is he goes for something that he thinks has got a bit of either humour to it or a the personality of the person writing the songs. I was writing almost, it was crap, this political kind of, I was listening to like loads of like Rage Against the Machine and Queens of Stone Age. I sent all the stuff to Michael and I'd written about 14 or 15 tracks. I was like, yeah, these are brilliant. He just emailed me back and goes, what are you doing? These are brutal. You're totally, these are just not you. This is so unhonest to me. Like, he couldn't fathom it. He used to stop messing around and start writing what you're good at. And that's writing simple stories that have happened to you. And that's what I think the domino effect is. We kind of play to our strengths in regard to our songwriting. Well, you see, it wasn't a difficult second album. I think that only applies to bands who sell 25 million copies all around the world and the eyes of the world are on you. Whereas the second thing with a record is you have to do two things with it. You have to show you've progressed as songwriters and as a band. And secondly, you cannot isolate who bought your first record and who came to all your gigs. And there was no fear of that happening to us because we essentially were playing music we liked to play and listen to. The reason we went with Trust Me, Doctor is we needed to build a bridge between the last record and this record. And there is some songs that if we went with them initially, people would have went, oh, they've changed their direction. You know, and we didn't want that at all. You know, you're sitting in KFC in bloody Ayanapa or something and some girl says, what do you do for a living? You were never like a labourer or anything. You were always like, I'm studying to be a lawyer, accountant or a doctor. And that was essentially what the song was about. In there somewhere would be probably the Fee Festival when nobody, I don't even think my parents knew I was in the band when we played the Fee Festival. I don't know how in the name of God we ended up in the bill, but we played it and nobody else could say they played Fee Festival at the time. So I think that was definitely a defining moment for the band. We kind of got a taste of what it could be like to be in a band. When the album, first album went platinum, that was a huge bonus for us. Like, not just because it went platinum, but because how hard we worked to get a platinum. We did, I don't know how many tours of Ireland to actually build up the fan base. It didn't happen, like, no amount of radio play and no amount of people writing about us was going to get the fans that we got by going out on the road. We take what we do very, very seriously, and it's totally our dream, it's what we want to do. And we don't take anything for granted. And sometimes I just hope that we don't look back and say we should have had a bit more fun with what we're doing and stop being so serious. It's not that we're serious, it's just that we're so focused on this happening and working and getting it right that I just really hope we don't look back and go, what? We should have been out absolutely destroying the place. That's not really an option either, but you know, that's one thing I hope never happens.
Thank you.